Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with another episode of the IOST Podcast. My name is Mike. I'm here with Dimitry.
And this is Q. I thought we were going with a new name this week, Mike. What's going on?
Well, even though we are marketing professionals, we didn't coordinate well enough on the name there. So I'm not going to blame Q, but Q kind of screwed it up.
Oh man,
a little bit to me, but we're not gonna. I don't think he can hear us right now, so it's okay.
Yeah, you muted him.
I think I muted him.
No, I hear everything loud and clear. And actually, this is like an inception. We're actually great marketing professionals because all anyone's going to be talking about is the fact that the IOST podcast was not rebranded, and they want to wait till the end of the month to hear. So
what could be coming?
Oh, God. Yeah, if you guys can guess the name, I don't want to give away any clues, but we'll figure it out. But anyways, we got to, what's up?
I was going to say, we'll give away something if somebody can come up with that name.
Yeah.
My goodness.
Yeah. Oh,
it's pretty unique.
Somehow, without any hints, figure out the name of this podcast. Power to you.
Q will travel to you and host a podcast with you.
There you go.
How about that? You willing to do that?
I will drag all of this podcast equipment and go to wherever you may be if you figure this out.
You do it like live, you know, like IRL.
I like that. We might drop a hint maybe a week before. Let's do that and see if they can actually get it. I'm not flying out there though. But anyways, we got a good episode this week. We've got a roadmap and emoji announcement. So the roadmap was dropped, and also a little bit more information on the Emogi Network, formerly the Berminal Network. Is that true?
Berm, yeah. Essentially the Berm token going to the Emogi token. Yep.
Okay. We got IOSTPlay being hacked. We have Mike is headed to Europe. We also have a Inside IOST free wallet service, some Dapp stats to date, and comments from last week. So this should be a funny episode. I do want to start off by commenting on it. We read the comments on YouTube, but this comment was from Twitter. So Jimmy retweeted our IOST podcast, which thank you, Jimmy. Whenever you retweet our podcasts, it gets like 10,000 retweets somehow. So you are a popular man. So keep doing that. But anyways, Francois Normandin said 60 minutes ... Who has time for this ? Which we would say everyone apparently has time for this because they're watching the podcast, right?
Yeah. I mean, you know, we got time to make it. So you guys should have time to watch it.
Right.
I mean, exactly. One equals one, right?
Yeah.
And I think that's what Christopher here is saying when he says these are actually a great watch / listen. Can have it play in a tab while doing other things. Don't have to look at their ugly faces the whole time, you know? LOL.
Right. Oops. Yeah.
Well,
we'll wear more makeup.
You can watch Dimitri's desk. I don't have my camera on there. You know, it's just the charts.
That's true. It's only 8 minutes and there's no...
Yeah, exactly.
So it's just a desk, I'm imagining. Just a,
yeah.
An empty desk computer with broken keys.
Yeah, exactly.
So we do see comments on Twitter as well. Do not think you're safe if you're bashing our appearance on Twitter, because we view that as well. So shout out there. So let's just get into it, Mike. What do we got first? Dimitri as well. What do we got first here? Big announcement.
Yeah, so everybody's been calling for it. We got a roadmap update from IOST. If you take a look, you know, kind of some pros and cons to it, right? It's certainly nice to have the roadmap, but as Dimitri and I were talking about before the podcast, it is kind of broad, especially in kind of some phases or parts of it or whatever you want to call it. So, you know, they have some really interesting info there. Some things are starred, side chains are starred, cross chain integration essentially is starred. So, you know, there's potentially some really interesting things coming there. I don't know if that's just going to be side chains for popular dApps, right? Could it be, you know, Berm trying to go cross chain or something like this? Who knows? But all in all, it's good to see the roadmap. If you haven't seen it yet, check out the IOST blog on medium.com/IOST. You know, like I said, really nice to kind of have that update. I think as mainnet pushed through relatively quickly and certainly ahead of time from where IOST was originally kind of anticipating it to launch, there was this gap where people were like, okay, well, what's next?
Yeah.
Right? You got that typical kind of crypto investor or crypto user, whatever you want to call it, that, you know, tenacity and insatiability, kind of ready for what's next. So we've got that now.
Yeah, given how fast, you know, this industry moves, people constantly want to move just as fast, you know, after finishing the mainnet. One thing that I was looking at is the new proposal nodes governance. It's going to be huge. I know a lot of nodes were talking about it, you know, when they first announced that there's going to be a proposal to govern like nodes, basically. So that's going to be huge. And like you said, cross-chain deployment, they have it start, so it's going to be huge. Broad topics that they have here, you know, like adoption, for example, you know, like increasing adoption. One thing that was also interesting is staking economy. Basically, them attracting more entities that want to set up like pools, you know, like who are we pool and so on. Essentially provide staking services for IOST and then essentially growing the market cap of IOST. That's the way, you know, I see it, which is cool.
Gotcha.
So it says staking economy and it says more innovations within that staking economy. What do you guys think can be iterated on with staking inside IOST?
Well, I know DeFi has been a big focus as of late for them. So I would imagine that's kind of a big piece that they're looking at. Last week we talked about Profit, mm-hmm. which is that entity, you know, basically coming on board with IOST that's going to allow lending and borrowing of IOST in the same way you have that with ETH and Maker and DAI and that whole thing. So I would imagine we start to see more than just kind of a single, single tree or kind of a straight line between IOST, you stake it, you get more IOST, right? If there's now IUSD, the stable coin, and there's the ability for you to lend it and, you know, the ability for you to borrow IOST, which then you can, you know, obviously stake for more IOST, you kind of start to build this economy of sorts that kind of grows exponentially as more use cases are built on top of it, which is why they're probably referring to this as kind of like a staking economy in a lot of cases.
Right.
I know the consensus mechanism was like a huge thing. I know you actually, this is a little known fact for all of you that weren't listening to the IOST podcast, but Mike actually interviewed Jimmy back in the day, right?
Yeah, Jimmy and Ray. We got both of them on.
Okay, yeah. So Mike actually interviewed Jimmy and Ray, and part of the conversation that I remember specifically was the consensus mechanism and how it was going to work and how it was going to be decentralized and all these things. But what's kind of come up to me when I'm hearing Jimmy talk and I'm seeing this roadmap, and I like one of the pinned tweets on Jimmy's profile is just a guy talking about, it was IOST Africa talking about the staking rewards. That's Jimmy's pinned tweet. And so what that makes me think is, like, I don't know if back in the day when he was talking to you, if he thought that staking was going to, the way they set it up, was going to be such a big part of IOST, but it seems like more and more like IOST is like cementing itself as like a staking network, like one of the number one. And I think that's coming to Jimmy's mind more and more. Like how is he going to pin somebody's tweet just talking about the staking rewards if he doesn't think, and then obviously this roadmap has a lot to do with it as well.
Yeah. I mean, to me, staking is, and kind of a staking economy, if you kind of look at it broadly, is very simple, right? The more people that you have that are going to invest in the token and are going to use the token for dApps or for lending or for, you know, getting access to, say, the new Emogi token, which we'll talk about, aside from, you know, kind of just general investment and holding of the token, and aside from any sort of utility that's created for the token, staking is big because it locks up the tokens, right? You're essentially, even for a week, right? Understanding that it takes 7 days for those tokens to unstake. What is happening is, with that weak cliff there are tokens being removed from the circulating supply, right? Mm-hmm. So if you go onto an exchange and you buy 100,000 IOST, and you stake them, that is, at least for a week period there, removed from the circulating supply. So what it does is it alters the ratio of, you know, what has traditionally been you know, a supply of what, like 13 million circulating IOST tokens. So as you kind of remove that supply, and as other network effects happen, and as other, you know, demand for IOST happens, and as additional utility, you know, is kind of involved with the IOST token, you're increasing the demand but lowering the supply, right? Which, as we've seen with other kind of deflationary assets like Bitcoin, it, you know, it can tend to help the price. So by kind of combining all of these things and looking at the staking economy, I think that's probably why that's a major focus for Jimmy, because he understands that, you know, right now where we are in the market, everybody likes to certainly buy IOST at a penny and have it go up to a penny and a half or 2 pennies, right? You kind of want to get ahead of the curve, especially where we see altcoins today. So if you know, IOST can continue to grow the staking economy, continue to have more people who come on board, buy tokens, stake them, basically pull those tokens out of the circulating supply, even for a week, it's going to, you know, boost that ratio of demand to supply.
Yeah, and finding ways to incentivize, like you guys were talking about with the airdrops. If you can incentivize people to take tokens out of the total supply, or like at least for a little while, yeah, that's an awesome point.
Oh. Yeah, so I think that's probably his focus there. But obviously, it's not, you know, the end all be all, right? IOST still has to execute on a load more of those points with the roadmap, right? You know, you have to have real demand. You can't just create a staking token and everybody's kind of earning these tokens, but if the tokens don't have any inherent utility or there's no demand, it's kind of like, you know,
it's
kind of pointless to stake. So
cool. Well, I'm going to get into the next little topic here. This is going to be from our friends at Inside IOST. They created a pretty much a one-click service for creating an IOST account, which is a topic that's been brought up a lot by people, you know, that we've been talking to, nodes we've been talking to, people in the community we've been talking to. This is all about trying to get people to understand crypto. And it's funny because we listened to, I listened to Pomp today when he was on the Squawk Box, and also when he was live on his Twitter talking to the guys from Lolly. And the way that the guy from Lolly explained it was that, so they have a service where you can purchase goods online and you get Bitcoin back. It's like a rebate kind of thing. So the way they explained it was that, hey, we want to approach this just from a Bitcoin standpoint, just from a Bitcoin standpoint, because it gets too confusing for an average user to come in and see 10,000 tokens, you know, and what do I do with all of these and how do I do this? So they just approach it from a Bitcoin standpoint. And I like what Inside IOST did with creating a pretty much a one-click step for new users to understand how the IOST blockchain works, and not even really that, more so just getting an account, funding that account, and them sending them off to wherever they need to go. So if that is other dApps, if that's a DEX, if that's another exchange, but making it as easy as possible for new users to come in and create a wallet. So you go to insideiost.com, they have a very blatant CTA there that says, you know, get your, let me see what it actually says, create free IOST account. You go in there, and there's about 4 steps, and then you're pretty much set up. So you're creating your IOST account. You're importing your private key to the iWallet, which they have the download there. You deposit IOST from Binance or KuCoin, transact with your IOST, and they also have a voting section there. So that's that.
That's huge. Yeah, and I think part of that too was that we haven't really had a US-based wallet creation. You know, it's been Token Pocket, which I think is Japan, and you know, Pure Wallet, I think, was another one. So there's kind of been a handful overseas, but we haven't really had one here in the US or in North America. So yeah, I mean, absolutely. Shout out those guys over at Inside IOST. They're always doing a good job for IOST.
Yeah, I went actually through all the steps to check it out, how easy it is. It took me like 10 seconds to set up a wallet. And you know, it's free to set it up if you confirm your email address. So they basically cover the fee for the setup, and boom, you know, you have your private key and everything, and they move into educating, okay, what can I do now, you know, with IOST? Like, obviously you can stake it, you know, earn rewards, but there's also, you know, other things that they educate, which is, I think it's the way they designed their UX is awesome. Very simple.
it's ease of use, and it's I'm trying to think of what I'm actually going to say, but
it's purdy
use, and then it's education light was what I was trying to get at. You're not hitting them with the hard stuff, but you're giving them just enough to start what they should be doing, right? Which is staking, probably, which is probably going to adapt and trying it out, but it's all about education light and as well as ease of use. So that's awesome, man.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it think about how many people take down some IOST and don't stake it.
Right.
You know, that mm-hmm. staking ratio that we've talked about before is still, well, not at the bottom. It's also not at the top, right? Relative to other staking platforms. So it's kind of like second or third, something like that, compared to some of the other big ones like Tron and EOS and whatnot. So the more we can get people to stake, the more basically utility they're going to have, at least the more rewards they're going to have. And the more we can kind of, you know, continue to build on that staking economy.
We'll see how that staking ratio will be once we have some serious airdrops in play. You know, that's going to be huge.
Yeah, we'll have to follow that. All right, so we got Emogi Network, Mike. What do we got here?
Yes, so as a quick recap, one of the biggest projects on IOST, one of the biggest kind of application layer projects in crypto in general that we've been hyping up since we started this podcast, yeah, really in January or February or whatever, has been Berm, right? The Berm team, BERM, founded by one of the IOST co-founders, started as a small team. And as you can see in the announcement and in the various blog posts that IOST has been putting out over the last 2 weeks, it has grown very well. So essentially, the Berm team is moving away from the name the Berm token, which I think is good because Berm doesn't really mean anything. You know, it's not something that people can really connect to. And they're going to be calling it the Emogi Network, EMOGI. You know, I would imagine to offset any sort of kind of trademark or legal issues there. But the Emogi Network will act really in the same way that Ray described, I think, in that original interview that we had with him through ICO Alert, where, you know, he imagines this unique media and content distribution system, essentially, where you have your content creators, right? Those who are actually, say, creating the videos on Burmy, the app that you can get on iOS or Android. Then you also have your what they're calling content validators. Yep. And then, of course, you have your viewers or your users, right, who are using the brand new Emogi token and whatever, you know, whatever way. So the content creators are creating the content. In some cases, they might have some followers that are watching that content, but in many cases, they don't. So the Emogi Network has an interesting kind of aspect to it that allows these content creators, large or small, to attach some value of this emoji token to this piece of content. Then the content validators, which essentially act as kind of channels like you would see on YouTube,
right,
or content distributors, mm-hmm, right? They have the ability to go in, take that fee, and distribute it to their audience, right? So you kind of now have this interesting dynamic where even if you aren't a kind of a large content creator with a huge following, if you go and you buy up some emoji tokens, you can, you know, access very easily, and I would imagine in a very, you know, kind of user friendly way, you can access a much larger network to get your content out there. What this does for users is it allows users to continue to use the Burmy app like they've always wanted to, right? Burmy now has millions of users. South America is seemingly the largest area. You'll see that in the Emogi Network blog post. But users are relying on content validators to make sure that they're getting content that is top notch, right? Because if I'm a content validator, even if that fee is high, right, but the content is terrible, I might not necessarily distribute it because I don't want, you know, my audience to unfollow me because I'm just kind of, you know, taking the fee and I don't care about what my users think. So there's all sorts of super interesting kind of game theory mechanics here. But at the end of the day, the goal is basically to decentralize the content distribution setup through the access of this emoji token on the Burmy app.
Yep.
And, you know, they're basically going to distribute, you know, that token or give that token access to all of the millions of users they have already.
This is interesting. I actually tripped up over, I gave Mike a hard time last week for not reading some of the content before we started the podcast. And now I'm looking at this and it is kind of interesting because you could be a creator, not necessarily a validator, right? But you essentially want to be both of those things, right? If you create the content, you're the one that wants to disperse that content, not I create the content and then people bid to disperse my content out. What if no one bids for it? Then my content's not getting out there.
Yeah, kind of, right? So it's an interesting process in that both the content creators have power of their audience, but also this kind of middle layer of validators who, you know, assuming they have a reputable brand, reputable audience, post reputable content for their audience. I think throwing them in there, while they are making fees from the content creators, mm-hmm. I think the focus is really more on the users who can then trust that, you know, the content coming through Burmy is going to be of some value, because there is kind of this like funky new economy of sorts where everybody is incentivized in one way or another to post the best content. You know, if I post some goofy video that Dimitri and I record, I'm not going to spend, you know, $100 worth of emoji tokens to push that out. Right. But if we do like a really high profile one, then I might actually kind of put some advertising behind it. So, it's super interesting.
Yeah, I want to have this discussion next week after I can kind of think my thoughts through this. But essentially, as a content creator, you're so the validators have the community, not the content creators. Is that what I'm hearing?
I'm not fully sure because I don't think we've really seen it yet, but it's I would imagine it's going to be a little bit of both, where probably to start the validators are going to be strong. But then you're right. I mean, you might have a content creator who's also content right. validator.
Yeah. Cause it says
still speculation, obviously.
Okay. Cause it says the content validators elected by the community are tasked with picking the content they want to disseminate to their audiences. So right. That's interesting. Usually the content creator is the one with the audience, but now it's saying that this validator is the one with the audience.
It kind of reminds me of just like the influencers that you have, you know, on Instagram or other like platforms where, you know, if you are developing content, but you don't have a following of somebody who's like the influencer on that platform, then you would, you know, approach them and be like, hey man, can you like, you know, hook me up with just posting a couple of my content on your channel to your right. audience. And then essentially, you know, you will gain that audience, you know, from that influencer. So I think that's kind of the setup that
right. we're looking for. Yeah. So if I'm a vitamin and, you know, nutrients company or right. something, and I go to a major influencer and say, hey, you know, I'll give you, you know, so many thousands of dollars in all these free vitamins, in exchange, you know, take a video of you kind of taking this stuff and, you know,
chilling it.
Yeah, you're chilling it, you taking it, you know, working out, you know, taking the vitamins, whatever, you know, both are, I guess, technically content creators, but it's very much a validation coming from that influencer
right.
to the influencer's audience. And, but probably also vice versa, right? Because if that, you know, vitamin company, even the users that they have who might not be an audience of that influencer, if they see a giant influencer posting about it, it could definitely be, you know, considered validation kind of both ways, right? It's a two-way street to the creator's current audience and also, you know, obviously the validator's audience. So yeah, I mean, time will tell. I think the beauty of Berm in general and you know, what is now kind of the Emoji Network is that this isn't something where we're kind of like, oh, this is a great idea. Now, like, let's see who the first user is.
Yeah.
Right. Exactly. Like they've already kind of gone out and, you know, grabbed a few million users with South America being the primary area, I guess, because of a big distrust with the media and government.
Yeah. That's interesting that what they mentioned about it.
Yeah.
The reason why they grew.
It's worth a read for sure. And will certainly be interesting as kind of that emoji token gets launched and hopefully airdropped, like we said.
Mm. Yeah, definitely. It's worth putting out here that it says consumers can theoretically purchase premium data or information directly from their creators. So I'm interested, man. I'm interested. Yeah. So if you guys know of any other apps that work this way, because essentially you don't need a token for this to work. This could be done with a centralized app as well. If you guys know any apps that actually work this way, please let us know in the comments, because I'm super interested in how this process works.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yep. Well, I think we are going to run into some Dimitry's desk highlights.
Highlights, yeah. So for the full episode, obviously we post that on the channel. But for you guys, just a little teaser, see what's going on.
Check it out.
Welcome back, guys, to another episode of Dimitry's Desk. Today is August 5th. This is episode 8. And man, we have a lot of action going on in crypto market. So here's the agenda for today's episode. We're going to run through the charts as always. Going to take a look at the most important charts for BTC, Ethereum. We're going to look at EOS. We're going to look at IOST, of course, and see where things are and where they might be heading. Last week was packed with fundamental news. We're going to cover a little bit of a macro. We had the Fed cutting rates. We have China's dealing with Hong Kong protests. We have tons of things to cover. I'm going to also cover an indicator, a report that comes out every week that shows you where the futures are positioned for BTC. We can see where the institutional traders are positioning themselves week after week for BTC. With that being said, let's jump into it.
All right, what another wonderful episode. Actually, a wonderful highlight of Dimitry's Desk. For the real episode, go to YouTube and view that like the rest of us. We have an IOSTPlay hacked situation. But before that, I did want to talk to Mike, because Mike, where are you headed tomorrow?
I'm out of here. So probably when you're seeing this, I will be on a jet plane headed to Europe doing...
Are you going to Eastern Europe?
No, not Eastern Europe. I try to.
I was gonna pass.
I got so much Eastern Europe going on right here.
You know, if you can take a couple bags,
a couple black duffel bags.
Yeah, exactly.
Some clothes, you know.
Yeah. Don't worry about it.
Usually, you bring it back. Usually, don't take it.
We'll see.
It's got to work somehow, right?
Exactly.
Got to work both ways. Demon's got to make his money both ways.
Right. Yeah, I could probably do that for you. I'll just leave him. Leave him in London and get him halfway there.
Oh, that's fine. Yeah, I'll have Sergey pick it up.
Okay. Great. So I'll make sure to drop that off to Sergey. But yeah, doing London. So whenever I come back, I'll be full of some London pub drink, and then we're doing Italy a little bit as well. So full of some Italian pasta, and probably about 5 pounds heavier and a little sluggish in 2 weeks here on the next podcast. So. Everybody make sure not to listen to the next two podcasts. Make sure to just check in 3 weeks. So it looks like I'm really the one bringing the viewers here.
You're gone for two podcasts? Wow. I mean, there might be a lot of things changed by the time you come back, Mike. Who knows?
Who knows? You never know.
Maybe even the name. Who knows? We'll see. All right. So we've got the IOSTPlay hacked announcement here. So this actually came from the IOST Telegram group. I guess people started to realize that their contract was getting attacked, and I'm going to tell you the story really quick. So basically, a month ago, they had found out that there was a bug in the smart contract that allowed for someone to bet more than the maximum limit that's set. So right now, if the way they have it set it up is if the bankroll that they have on their contract is 1 million IOST. Your max bet at any one time could be 40,000 IOST, which is 4% of 1 million. So basically, that contract got exploited. There was something wrong with it. They pushed it to their dev. Their dev said it was fixed. They pushed it live. And then it says, and I'm going to read it quote for quote here. Yesterday, around 10 hours ago, a player by the name of Genius Money or IOST account I Am Legend was found winning far in excess of this maximum bankroll limit. The same smart contract developer was alerted of the issue and in a panic deployed a patch to prevent an account named I Am Legend from receiving payouts on winning rolls. This patch was not reviewed by the core team due to the time constraints of this emergency. Before this patch was deployed, our bankroll was depleted to 400,000. So I don't know what their bankroll was beforehand, but this is an interesting situation because the dev pushing that quick patch live made it so that this guy who was exploiting the contract actually got exploited by the teams, because he was continuing to roll at a max amount level for however long he did, and he was winning but not receiving anything back. So the guy, yeah, but they go on to say that after this all happened, the guy ended up with $17,000. He ended up with $17,000 after his winnings plus whatever he lost when he was just betting with no winnings coming back. But interesting situation. I mean, and that's also kind of a you know, it brings up the decentralized casino approach, right? You know, a lot of these decentralized apps are actually, you know, pretty centralized when it comes to that. So was it right for them to for the guy to be that was exploiting this to be then exploited himself? This is all just kind of interesting. And should they pay it back, all the money that he lost when he was exploiting this contract? Do they pay it back? So they ended up not paying him back, obviously. But yeah, it's an interesting situation. What do you guys think?
It's kind of like what are you saying about decentralization and centralization? You know, if you have an issue like that happens on a completely decentralized, you know, network, then hey man, that's just that it is what it is, you know.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, in that sense, if you have some centralization in that factor where you can, you know, deploy fixes and maybe, you know, even reverse some transactions to a certain extent, you know, that could be helpful. But I think there's obviously pros and cons on both sides, but I think if it was fully decentralized, then, you know, there'll be much more,
you know. Yeah. If it was fully decentralized, I mean, that pretty much be the end of IOST play. I mean, hopefully we obviously see them rebound here. I know they've seen, you know, some significant user growth and volume growth and have been, you know, other than, you know, the Emogi Network and Berm, have probably been one of the, you know, if not the biggest dApp for IOST. So it's definitely a big hit. It sucks to see that happen. I mean, I, as of late over the last, you know, few years, have been a fan of this kind of hybrid decentralization model, sure, meaning that just as IOST has done, just as many other, you know, you see this with centralized exchanges a lot, but a lot of other cryptocurrency companies do, they start the kind of the path to decentralization by trying to decentralize some pieces of the business or the product or whatever, but not kind of fully throwing it out there to the wild. You know, I think EOS is probably one of the best examples of this. There are some other ETH projects that have tried to go fully decentralized and
itself, you know, that happened to ETH itself.
Yeah, and that's obviously a whole conversation, you know, a whole rabbit hole too. I mean, they kind of took the hybrid model a little bit by, you know, by reversing a lot of those DAO issues. But, you know, there are pros and cons on each side, yeah, right? Like, yeah. I see both sides of the argument as being, okay, well, you should just fully decentralize, and if you fuck it up, you fuck it up, right? Or you should, you know, kind of do it halfway, and that way you can, you know, as you have issues because you're a startup, you can try and fix those. But other than that, I mean, the biggest thing for me is that it seems like time and time again, whether it's an exchange hack or, you know, some dApp hack on some network, it comes back to the fact that code is king,
right?
If you're kind of taking shortcuts or you know, skipping out on some pieces there that you're not supposed to skip out on, it may very well end in disaster. So you hate to see it.
Yeah, and it did end in disaster, not only for IOST play, but the dev got fired from the dApp, so or at least from the dApp team. But they made a great point. I mean, if you cheat on a bet at a casino, you likely don't get those winnings back, or the original bet. So I'm not sure if that's law, but that's what they did. So great points all around. I mean, IOST play is going to rebound from this. They've done real well, but it just goes to show, I mean, this happens to pretty much everybody.
Yeah. I think if you do it in a real casino, you lose your kneecaps
too. Yeah.
Joe Pesci comes out and it's like, hey, what you doing?
One more time on that impression.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You hate to see it. Yeah. You know, shout out IOST Play for the transparency. You know, as they kind of get some things together, I'm sure they'll be back. But, you know, this is a brand new network, right? Everybody, you got to be cautious out there. Fortunately, it wasn't, you know, it wasn't something kind of more serious for a lot of the users. It seems to kind of have affected IOST Play yeah. more than their users. So there is some silver lining there. But, you know, stay woke out there.
Yep.
Yeah, stay woke. I'm sure it affected the divs for the day. But anyways, Dapp stats to date. What do we got?
Yes.
I didn't even see this. What is this?
Yeah, so another one you didn't see.
I don't see a lot of these things, apparently. Well, you don't have the link on the dashboard.
That's true. It's my bad. Okay, so IOST has been releasing these biweekly reports. They have now expanded it as the kind of Dapp ecosystem, or just basically kind of Dapp, ecosystem's the right word, right? That's continued to grow within IOST. So they now have a IOST Dapp biweekly report and some really interesting data here. As of late, we have, about 38 Dapps on IOST. Some significant volumes. We have just about 200,000, it's, you know, I don't know if that's denominated in IOST. I would imagine that's denominated in IOST. So 200,000 IOST worth of volume, about a little over 300,000 transactions. And then, you know, volume and transactions are both on a 24-hour basis. And then daily active users is just over 15,000, with the majority of the dApps being gambling and gaming. Really, the majority of transactions of volume of users, you know, are really all on gambling and gaming. So even without Berm here, it's nice to see some decent volume, some decent transaction numbers, certainly some decent amount of users, at least as what, you know, has been reported. Right. I mean, there's this constant conversation of like, okay, well, how many users these are real users? Right. How much is botted? And, you know, you kind of have to just kind of leave that conversation where it is and take the data for what it's worth in a lot of cases. So, you know, a little over 15,000 daily active users, assuming they're not all botted. I'm happy with that. I mean, that's solid growth since mainnet, I think.
Yeah. And, you know, I've spoke about this before where, you know, these like gambling dApps, they're obviously just the initial stages of any network to, you know, to benchmark it in terms of transactions and so on, right? So even if there's some bots involved in there that are performing this duty of, you know, having these transactions and making sure that the network is benchmarked, you know, because you had like some CryptoKitties come out and broke the whole network, you know? So like, yeah, something like this, you know, it's great to see the stats are going up, even if there's some bots in there, you know, that's
yeah. Right. I'm checking the stats now. I'm trying to go into dapp.com, but having some trouble. That probably is, if we're talking 24-hour volume on the gaming level, I would say that's $44,000. I don't think it's 44,000 IOST. So
I guess that makes more sense. Yeah.
Yeah. It's probably, and again, that volume isn't like what's being, you know, it's just being what's like essentially rolled. So it probably is around that 44,000 mark. So anyways, yeah, man, I like this Dapp report here. That's something new that they've added. So yeah, I think we're doing well as far as the dApps go. I haven't looked at these games. You guys kind of gave me a hard time on that. What games they got on there?
Yeah, man.
Like, well, they break it down between, you know, on these stats, they break it down between three categories: gambling, games, and other. Trade volumes, games lead it with $158,000 worth in 24 hours. Transaction-wise, gambling leads it with $169,000 transactions in a 24-hour basis, and gambling also leads users like by and far with pretty much like 90-92% of total users. So you know, as far as some of the other games, we've talked through a lot of these, Sticky Goo, Flappy Birds, Doodle Jump. I mean, these are, you know, more of kind of your typical blockchain games that we're seeing, right? Like your Atari style, you know, birth of blockchain games. So
yeah,
nothing really standing out as kind of revolutionary.
Yeah, these Dapp Birds guys, these Dapp Bird Studios have produced multiple games. You can see it in Doodle Jump as well as Flappy Bird, but you see the Dapp Birds and IOST partnership there. These Dapp Birds guys have put out, I don't know exactly which games, but I've seen their logo multiple times on multiple of these mobile games. So they seem pretty involved.
You know, one thing that they don't mention in that report, it would be nice to see, is the demographics of the users, you know, where are the users coming from, you know, let's say for each app or whatnot, you know, what is their market, major market, you know, it's like for, you know, for Emogi, we know it's Latin America, you know, and what about the rest of these guys? You know, it'd be cool if that was included too.
Yeah,
definitely. What did Alan from IOST Cash say about that? Do you remember, we asked him that initial question and he had the data. Do you remember what he said?
I can't remember.
Yeah. It would help to have all these demographics kind of explained to us. Are they mostly from Asia? Are they mostly from the U.S.?
Right.
Is that Latin America? That's a great question.
Yeah, I would imagine obviously most are Asian based, yeah, because the Dapp you know, creators are Asian based. The interesting thing to me is kind of like, what's the business model around these Dapps? A lot of time, I mean, certainly fees, right? If you can kind of take down some fees, but you know, is it better to have one quality Dapp, or is it better to have 20? You know, kind of not subpar, but I guess like, you know, simpler Dapps where, you know, you can kind of add up users across a multitude of various games. You kind of like, we seem to be kind of moving into that territory with at least gaming Dapps where you have a breakdown between, okay, hey, like here's a really unique, here's a cool gaming Dapp. You know, if you consider CryptoKitties a gaming Dapp and that whole kind of process of game, they're obviously, you know, leading the pack from a brand standpoint, but then you have like, you have kind of this new like arcade type thing popping up where it's like, okay, well, we don't have like, you know, one giant game, but we have like 15 really cool games. You can come play Blackjack, you can come play Flappy Bird, and you can come do this and obviously earn tokens and that whole deal. So it's, you know, we're seeing a little bit of some evolution there, it seems too.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah, and they did mention that, you know, in the past that, hey, we don't want to have just gambling Dapps, you know, that, remember that one focus that we were on a call with them, they were saying that basically they're looking to expand non-gambling Dapps.
Yeah. And honestly, the move to mobile is happening outside of crypto too. So a lot of gaming studios are going more mobile focused. You can reach more users. You don't have to, you know, reach the user that has an $800 desktop or above. You can just, and everyone has a mobile phone. So I agree with you though. Like, it needs to be a quality Dapp, I think. I don't know. Now, we might be proven wrong. It's all timing, right? But like, if Dapp Birds can bring in a ton of users, then, you know, great.
Right.
Like, you guys did it with the shotgun approach of having multiple small Dapps within like a little ecosystem. So yeah,
Sometimes, yeah, the simpler the Dapp, the, you know, the better. Like, if you think about in the past, like Candy Crush. Like, you know, that's like such an easy app, like, you know, there's really not much there,
like,
you
a
know?
Like an updated Tetris,
basically. Yeah, exactly, you know, so it's like stuff like this, it can actually like really blow up and gain a lot of users. So maybe having, you know, that arcade style like simple Dapps and like multiple of them to see which ones will catch on to users, you know, it might be a good, you know, good way to go about it. You know, if you think of like Berminal and Burmy, you know, they've developed Berminal, they developed Burmy, now they're allocating more resources towards, right, you know, Emogi. So
what's with Mike and Tetris? This is the second episode Mike's brought up Tetris. Are you a Tetris guy?
Maybe it's the new name of our podcast. Maybe we're going to call it the Tetris Podcast.
That is a great hint.
That's actually pretty cool. Yeah. Great hint.
Yeah. I love it. Yeah. Until these Dapp developers, that they're Dapp Birds, actually makes a English version and it isn't, you know, doesn't have Korean on the front page, I probably won't add them to my Dapp rankings. I know you guys are asking me to put them in the Dapp rankings, but these are like blatantly Korean. So, you know, until that happens, I'm not going on.
Hard stance.
Yeah.
Just putting his foot down.
Yeah, people are going to be pissed.
Well, Q, you have comments from last week. What are the people saying?
Yeah, so we already got to Christopher and Francois on Twitter, but we're going to hop into YouTube now. So we've got MetaCrypto. He says, nice one, can't wait for the new name. And then he has content suggestions, which I need to get to YouTube for. So if you can buy me some like 15 seconds worth of time, I can get there. Let's come on, quick.
Sorry about the no new name, but it's coming. We promise. And to Christopher and Francois, which is like the most dynamic duo on Twitter
you've
ever heard. Like, I don't really think we're that ugly. I'm wearing a collar today.
Yeah.
That's true.
I did my hair today.
Yeah, so. Demon did his
you
hair.
You didn't do your hair because you're wearing a hat. I know.
Yeah, I'm wearing a hat.
Demon, that's my favorite shirt that you got on. So when Demon's wearing the HODL shirt, that's when you, other than what's the Nike one?
What's just HODL it.
Yeah. Just HODL. Yeah. Exactly.
I wore it last time, actually. Yeah.
All right, so way more than 15 seconds worth of filler there, but MetaCrypto said, nice one, can't wait for the new name. So yeah, you're going to have to wait a little longer. Content suggestions, because we asked at the end of the last episode. Interview other nodes. U.S. exchanges post-September. So I don't know if, I guess we have to switch business models. We're going to turn into a U.S. exchange post-September. That's not funny?
No, I think what he's...
Know what he's saying.
You smart ass.
I really like this last comment. I want to hear what you guys have to say. Try to bring node validators from other projects. Course One, for example, their validator nodes for Cosmos, Lumen, Ren.
Interesting.
Yep. Yeah. I mean, we've been working on that. We actually, what was the name of the node? Witex?
Which one?
There was one that we brought over, and I know Connor's had a good hand in helping people set up their nodes. But if you look, like, most of the largest validators are actually already set up on a lot of the chains. I mean, it's a, from an investment standpoint, it's a decent business model. And the fact that a lot of these guys are investing in these projects at the private sale stage, they've got some money behind them. They can get the tokens cheaper. They can get a lot of them. They can stake and be, you know, in the case of, let's say, like a Cosmos or an EOS or something, they can be in that top 100 or that top 21.
Yep.
You know, get the necessary inflation to, you know, to make sure that investment is somewhat steady, and then kind of cash out, you know, towards the top. So it's a decent business model. And obviously we've seen IOST bringing on a ton of staking partners too. So
yep.
You know, as far as that point, I think IOST has done a pretty damn good job of kind of expanding that staking economy. One thing on that other comment too, regarding the US exchanges. So this is seemingly a big question for many as we move closer to September, and it's not one that we're getting a lot of answers from Binance on, as to kind of what this process will look like.
Right.
So if you look at IOST, really the only exchange that is quote unquote US based that has a significant amount of volume and lists IOST is Binance. So when they move to Binance US, the question that I think this comment is bringing up is, you know, okay, well, if Binance US does not list IOST, which rumors have said that it will, you know, is IOST going to go out and get listed on a US exchange? Right. I can tell you we're working on that. We're trying to get IOST listed on a handful of other spots. You know, Coinbase is a big one. They've basically come out this past week and said that they expect that 90% of the total crypto market cap will eventually be listed on Coinbase, which is a huge statement. And we've also started to kind of see that Coinbase price effect come back a little bit. They announced they were going to be listing Matic and Harmony and some others, and we saw that price pump. So, you know, from our standpoint, we're working on it. From the comment standpoint, it's definitely a worthwhile concern. You know, I wouldn't worry about it too much with an IOST, simply because they are really more of an Asian and now Latin American focused project. The U.S. growth has, you know, has not been as strong. And the second point is that because they didn't do an ICO, because they didn't do a public sale, from a legal standpoint, they're way better off than most projects, yeah. Which is going to, you know, kind of lend positives to the argument that Binance US should list them. So, yeah, that, you know, sorry for stealing all the thunder there again.
No, that's interesting. I, you know, seeing Coinbase, announce these like proposals or, you know, rumors of like, oh, here, these are the tokens that we're reviewing to list next. It's great because like, you know, Coinbase had, you know, before Coinbase did not want to list anything, right? Mm-hmm. You know, don't talk about it. That said, you know, we have all these like four coins and that's it. But now they're like actively, you know, going through it, which is great, you know, and like you said, IOST shouldn't have any problem because they didn't have an ICO, you know.
Yeah, I think there's an initial Binance list too that we have shown on this podcast a couple times that it wasn't confirmed or denied by the team, but it showed a bunch of coins that were going to be listed on this Binance US exchange, and IOST was on there. So we'll have to see. I was really looking forward to us creating a US exchange post September. So we'll have to we'll have to figure that out later at some point. We got Electric Funk with running to the store to get some Drano right now. So that was. Our man that was voting for us and wanted to know what was going on with his staking reward. So we told him to get some Drano. The man's getting Drano. We got Crypto Philosopher here. Darkest hour is right before the dawn, LOL. So he's probably listening to Dimitri's desk. we've got, I'm rolling through this, man. I'm on fire. All right, here we go. I'm curious, since Burmy pays out in Ether or PayPal, will they add IOST as an option?
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah. If it's not, I mean, if it's not kind of all emoji, I would imagine a lot of it is emoji, which should most likely be what they're calling an IRC20 token,
yep.
Right? So kind of like you have your ERC20 tokens on ETH. So I would imagine that's kind of the focus now that they've announced the Emogi Network. So they want everything, you know, be it. You know, kind of the content creators issuing their reward to the validators, or it's just kind of general remittance, which if you read that article has been another focus for IOST, where they want to go as far as basically the emoji token being just a general kind of, you know, non-fiat remittance mm-hmm. token for Latin America, which, you know, if pulled off would be insanely right. giant.
Yeah, that'd be huge. But yeah, you know, in regards to that comment, basically just doing ETH and PayPal to start with, right? It's just the initial start, yeah, for sure. You know, I think they will, obviously they'll have emoji, but IOST, I don't see any issues adding that as well. You know?
Awesome. Well, we'll move on to the next one. We've got Jason Stallings' burner account here, Crypto Philosopher. Blockchain Arcade is a great project.
Come on, Jason. Real names only.
We know it's you. No, Blockchain Arcade actually is great. I can't wait to see what new games they put out on their platform. We got Nora Perez. Nora, we got to do like a dance every time. Smash the like button, viewers and subscribers. I love it. All right. And then we've got a more... We've got a different question from Jason Stallings / Crypto Philosopher. I was thinking about it, and there are already some solutions for staking and using tokens. On Laby Pool, you can stake and don't need to worry about 7 days. This was interesting because he says there's a fee for withdrawal. Also on Block, they have the same feature, but with no fee.
Interesting. So on Block has the kind of lightning unstaking period or whatnot. They're, you know, that same concept where you don't have to wait for the 7 days.
That's what Jason Stallings / Crypto Philosopher says.
Yeah, I mean, that's big. I mean, it's been crazy, just as kind of a side point, it's been crazy to see how much the on-block pool has grown.
Yeah.
I think we were talking about this before the podcast. They're up to like 128 million votes or, mm-hmm. or something crazy. If you look at BIS or elsewhere.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, this kind of goes back to the topic of, right, like staking ecosystem, DeFi. I mean, there are needs in the ecosystem that are or could be profitable, there are going to be various participants or outside businesses that are going to come in and execute solutions. Right. You know, like that's the beauty of this, you know, basically kind of decentralized, you know, free reign ecosystem. You know, you don't have to get licenses or anything to come in and participate and potentially, you know, not just deliver a solution to users and other ecosystem participants, but to come in and make some serious cash.
Yeah. And there's not much, you know, like red tape or barrier of entry. As a matter of fact, you know, the IOST team is open to helping you out to do those things, you know, if you have a great idea.
Yep.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, that's going to wrap up today's podcast, at least the topics for today's podcast. Did you guys have anything you wanted to get out before we shut the lights down?
Well, Mike, have a good trip. You know, we'll have to have some really cool people to interview, you know, while you're gone. So, but yeah, have a good trip, man.
Yeah, appreciate it. One other point that I kind of didn't put together before the podcast, but the IOST token price was hanging around a penny for a long time. IOST Play gets hacked, 17K. Now it's, you know, 9.5, 9.6, 9.4, something like that. Two and two together.
Put your little foil hat on, everybody. We got some theories in here.
Science.
Well, here's what we got to look into that. But here's what I want. Can you send us like quick little snippets of your trip? Just
100%.
You just record it on your phone. Send it to me as a file. I'll put it in the next week's podcast. And we'll have to get like a cutout picture of you.
Yeah. Like
I'm down. You got it.
Okay.
We're out of here.